Well, welcome this morning. We are today in Joshua chapter 17. Again, the choir's getting prepared for Palm Sunday when they will be singing quite a bit. And so good to hear them this morning. Joshua chapter 17 this morning. The title of the message today is When Complaining Will Do You No Good. If you'd like to follow along and don't have a Bible, please raise your hand when the gentlemen come down through, and they'll be sure to place one in your hand this morning. We think of complaining, there's a lot of different things that come to our minds. I remember a story about a man who took a vow of silence. He wanted to become a monk, and so he went to a monastery. He talked to the head monk, and the monk said, "You have to take a vow of silence, and you can only say two words every 3 years." And so the man agreed, and after 3 years had gone by, the head monk called him in and said, "Well, what are your two words?" He said, "Food cold." 3 more years went by, and the head monk came to him again and said, "Again, what are your two words this time?" And he said, "Bed hard." 3 more years went by, and the head monk came to him and said, "Well, it's that time of year again. What do you have to say?" And he said, "I quit." Well, the head monk said, "I'm not surprised. You've done nothing but complain since you've gotten here." This morning, we're going to talk about the complaining that comes to Joshua via the two tribes here, the sons of Joseph. You look in your scriptures, you'll see with me here in the book of Joshua, chapter 16, that the sons of Joseph went from Jordan at Jericho to the waters of Jericho on the east, and it describes where they had gone. In verse 4, it says, "The sons of Joseph, Manasseh, and Ephraim received their inheritance." And it describes the inherited area there for them. In verse 10, it says, "But they did not drive out the Canaanites who lived in Gezer. So the Canaanites live in the midst of Ephraim to this day, and they became forced laborers." Well, this may seem like a passage of scripture that doesn't have that much relative content to us in this year, 2017, but I would tend to differ with that assumption and say to you this morning that there is a lot of information here that will be very useful to you and me to apply in our Christian life. Let's look to the Lord to bless our time together in His Word, shall we? God, we come to You this morning so very mindful of Your wisdom. Lord, there are so many passages here in the New Testament and in the Old Testament that teach us valuable truth. May this passage today speak to our hearts. And may we understand, Lord, what was at the bottom of the problem here and how we may avoid it, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, at this point in time, there has been some wonderful things happening in the book of Joshua. And I don't have to go through and probably recount all of them for you, but there were some warnings that God had actually given to the people of Israel prior to them getting into the land. And what I'd like to do for you this morning is just refresh your mind. And if you take your Bible and go back a little bit to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6, there's a concern that God has for His people. And it's a very real concern. In chapter 6 and verse 10, we read God saying, "Then it shall come about when the Lord your God brings you into the land which He swore to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you, great and splendid cities which you did not build, and homes full of all good things which you did not fill, and hewn cisterns which you did not dig, vineyards and olive trees you did not plant, and you eat and are satisfied." Then God says, "Then watch yourself, that you do not forget the Lord who brought you from the land of Egypt and out of the house of slavery. You shall fear only the Lord your God and worship Him." People of Israel have come a long way since this period of time. In fact, last time we were together here looking into this study in Joshua, we referenced a man by the name of Caleb. And Caleb was an exceptional individual, a great man of faith, a great man who wanted to see God work in a marvelous way. And you may remember that Caleb comes and he approaches Joshua in the most humble of ways. He looks to Joshua and says, as Moses has made a promise that where my feet have trod, I might have my inheritance there, I come to you and I ask for my inheritance. Specifically, I want the hill country. I want that mountain, the mountain that the Lord has given me. And when Joshua gives him that mountain, gives him that hill country, you see the fulfillment of the promise of God. Here in Joshua chapter 17, it's quite a bit different. The whole temperament is different. The way in which the sons of Joseph approach Joshua is not in harmony with the attitude of Caleb whatsoever. Instead, we see a proud people who are dissatisfied, who are coming to complain. I want you to see, first of all, as we understand this, that in verse 4, it says, they came near before Eleazar the priest and Joshua the son of Nun, and before the leaders, saying, the Lord commanded Moses to give us an inheritance among the brothers, our brothers. So according to the command of the Lord, he gave them an inheritance among their father's brothers. And thus there fell 10 portions to Manasseh, beside the land of Gilead and Bashan, which is beyond the Jordan, because the daughters of Manasseh received an inheritance among the sons. And the land of Gilead belonged to the rest of the sons of Manasseh. This was a very extensive piece of property. The first thing I want you to see as we begin our journey here in Joshua chapter 17 is that you and I need to praise the Lord from obedient hearts and refuse to become bitter towards the Lord. I notice here in this passage that their provision was according to the providence of God. The providence of God had determined where there would be these boundaries. And so the map behind me shows you where the 12 tribes of Israel find their allotments. You may notice, in really directing your attention to Manasseh there, you'll find that Manasseh, Gad, and Reuben are all on the eastern side of the Jordan River. And Manasseh has a very, very large area. In fact, when you look at it and you look at what Judah has Simeon within it, and so the land mass itself is even greater here for the people of Manasseh. Over on the eastern shore, as it were, there's actually some land of promise. The area of Bashan and Gilead are very, very well known to be exceptional pieces of property. And so Manasseh has received from the Lord that which is truly, truly great. But it doesn't end right there. If you notice on the western side, you have Jezreel and you have Megiddo. And this area right here is exceptional as well. When you think of Megiddo, what do you think of in the New Testament? Armageddon, exactly. And you think of Jezreel, we often think of the Valley of Jezreel. The Esdraelon Valley is one that is incredibly lush. It is that definition of a land flowing with milk and honey. And to Manasseh goes the best of the best. They have got nothing, as I would understand it, to complain about whatsoever. Their land mass is huge. They have all types of things at their disposal. They have beautiful land that will allow them to spread out and to be able to prosper for all the time that they are there. All the future that God has for them is ready to be taken advantage of. I'm reminded that God is a gracious provider, is he not? He is a gracious provider. When God calls upon his children today to live the Christian life, he calls upon us to live the Christian life from the standpoint of living victoriously. Do you believe that? Which is precisely why Jesus Christ, when he was leaving, said, you are going to receive the Comforter, the Holy Spirit of God. you would live victoriously. You see, God has prepared for his church to triumph in this world, to be victorious, to go out and to continue to evangelize so that the church of Jesus Christ begins its growth and continues its growth and sees a maturity in its growth. In the life of the individual Christian, God wants us to live a life that is victorious. In Joshua chapter 13 and verse 6, God would say to the people of Israel, I am doing everything for you. I want you to notice that it is God who has determined the boundaries that are being spoken of. When we look at this, we see in verse 6 there, where God says, I will drive them out from before the sons of Israel, only allot it to Israel for an inheritance as I have commanded you. Now therefore, apportion this land for an inheritance to the nine tribes and the half tribe of Manasseh. It's the reason it's called a half tribe is because we have one on the half of it's the portion on the east side of the Jordan River, and the other half is on the western side of the Jordan River. God has given to the people of Israel everything that he promised to them. In fact, God has been working all of these victories. It's been God who's been doing it all. Isn't that true? When the Bible says, I will make your enemies thy footstool, truly, that is what God is and has done. The victories that have been won have been absolutely miraculous in their content. God is the one who's been driving out the enemy, has he not? I don't see any of these huge conflicts where we have head-to-head confrontation, the people of Israel, and they're fighting, and there's a question of whether or not they're going to win or not. I see God putting to flight the enemy. I see the people of Israel trailing them down the trail, cutting them down, and winning the victory. I see God miraculously taking a number of soldiers whose number is greater than the sand of the seashore and destroying them utterly. I see God as having his fingerprints all over the promised land. God is winning the victory, and it is a tremendous, tremendous blessing. Where's the bad news? So what's the problem? Little quiz for you to see if you were paying attention. How many portions did God give to Manasseh? 10. But we pick this up over here in Joshua chapter 17, and you'd figure that they got absolutely nothing to speak of. By the time we come to Joshua 17, in verse 14, the sons of Joseph spoke to Joshua saying, why have you given me only one lot and one portion for an inheritance, since I'm a numerous people whom the Lord has thus far blessed? Well, welcome to the complaint department. I don't think Joshua heard lots of these complaints, but he's hearing it now, isn't he? Complaining is interesting. Sometimes there are valid things to complain about, and other times there's really nothing to complain about. I woke up this morning, and the first thing I did, knowing I was preaching this message, was to complain. I looked out the window and I said, why is it dark? Whose idea is it to change clocks? Seriously, this is nuts. And then I'm driving to church this morning, and I'm listening to the Christian station, and the one preacher gets done, and they're transitioning over to Ravi Zacharias, and they give the weather, and they say, we are expecting 8 to 12 inches of snow this week. I about drove off the road. Complain? I have something to complain about. Do you have anything to complain? I mean, so we complain about all kinds of things, and some of these things are valid, and some of these things really are not all that valid. I mean, there's this little guy, and he can't stand the heat. He's in a tuxedo. He's got something to say about it. He's not too happy. Maybe you've seen this piece of paper. It's the complaint department issued paper. And that square, if you actually saw this paper, it's 8.5 by 11, and the square that you put your complaint is about 1/4 of an inch around. You see, there's oftentimes not a lot of merit to complaining. Mark Twain said, don't complain and talk about all your problems. 80% of the people you talk to don't even care. And 20% think you deserve it. Pretty good wisdom. Well, here we are. We're dealing with the complaints that are coming to Joshua. And so, Joshua, what are you going to do? Here the sons of Joseph, Ephraim, Manasseh, are coming, and they want to get some resolution. And so we find, first off, that there's a discontentment. The first thing they're asking for is, why do we get one lot? But we know from the passage of Scripture here that they had actually received 10 portions. Moses had given them not only the land on the west side of the Jordan River, where the rest of the tribes for the majority are, but he'd also given to them the land of Gilead, or simply that which is said to be the other side of the Jordan. They had received 1,300 square miles of some of the most valuable land in all of Israel. These lands abounded with springs. There was very little to be complaining about. The western Manasseh area was very important because it protected valuable passageways. There were passes through those hills and mountains that were to be protected, and so Manasseh had some enormous responsibility. As far as the responsibility goes, in Joshua 17, early on, it says he was the firstborn, this Manasseh, for he was the firstborn of Joseph. To Machir, the firstborn of Manasseh, the father of Gilead, were allotted Gilead and Bashan because he was a man of war. There was responsibility because on the eastern side of the Jordan River, enemies could come. And because these people were war-oriented and were able to protect Israel, they were very valuable. There was a lot to like about the portion that had been given. And yet there is discontentment among the tribes of Ephraim and Manasseh. Second thing is that they seem to be quite disillusioned. Notice back there in verse 14, not only have we only received one lot, but we're a numerous people. We got a lot of people for a little bit of land. In other words, we're so numerous that I don't understand why we don't have more land. And this is the complaint that comes to Joshua. As I showed you on that map, you see that Judah has a smaller land mass than Manasseh does, and yet when they counted the people, there were more people in Judah's tribe than Manasseh's tribe. And when we think of the census at Sinai, the tribe of Manasseh had 32,000. 40 years later, it has 52,000. But there's more people with Judah. They're disillusioned. And they doubted that they could ever get the victory. They talk about this here in verse 16. They said, the hill country is not enough for us. All the Canaanites who live in the valley have chariots of iron, both those who are in Bashan and its towns and those who are in the valley of Jezreel. And so they wondered, will we ever be able to really gain the victory? Well, those are good questions, aren't they? In Joshua chapter 17, verses 12 and 13, we read about some of the problems. Sons of Manasseh could not take possession of the cities because the Canaanites persisted, that's New American Standard word, they persisted in living in the land. Literally in the Hebrew, it means they were stubbornly. They were not going to leave easily. They wouldn't just get out. And so because of that, it came about when the sons of Israel became strong, they put the Canaanites to forced labor, but they didn't drive them out completely. Now, let me ask you a question, students of the book of Joshua. Did God tell the people of Israel to put these people into forced labor? No. That was their own idea. It was not the accepted will of God. You remember the whole Gibeonite deception? And when Joshua was fooled, he didn't go to God and pray to God and get the answer. What happened was that he had to honor an agreement and they became forced laborers. I'm not sure if the sons of Joseph are thinking to themselves, okay, fine, we'll make these people forced laborers as well. There is a problem with all of this thinking. And sometimes we could easily read through this, I believe, and miss it. The problem was, when Joshua gives them a solution, they reject it. Verse 15, after Joshua's listening to all these complaints, he says to them, if you're a numerous people, go up to the forest and clear a place for yourself there in the land of the Perizzites and Rephaim, since the hill country of Ephraim is too narrow for you. That is not what they wanted to hear. Caleb says, I want the mountain where the giants are. We're going to go up there. We're going to see God at work. And so Joshua, I love it. I don't even think Joshua's not trying to be a jerk. He is just telling them, matter-of-factly, you can go up into the hill country, and God will provide for you, and you'll beat up on those giants. They'll leave, and then you can cut the trees down, and you'll have property with a great view. And he says, you need to go down there to the valley of Jezreel, and I don't care if they have chariots of whatever, you need to drive them out, and then you'll have all the land that you need. Your problem is you're not taking the land. You're not doing what God has called you to do. That's where the problem is. Now, on the one hand, when you think of them saying, well, you know, the problem is, you know, they got iron chariots. Mercy. Why at this point are you worried about anything when God has been fighting all of your battles? When God has been winning victory after victory, why are you afraid of iron chariots? Have we not seen iron chariots in the past? Yes, we have. Didn't God wail on those things and you burn them with fire? Absolutely. Here's the one thing I want you to keep in mind. These people who are so strong that you can't drive them out, they got iron chariots and all that, you're going to somehow make slaves out of them. And they're going to willingly do that. Do you see the problem with that logic? We can't drive them out, and they're leaving on their own. You know, I mean, can you imagine? You know, they're persisting. They're stubbornly. They won't leave. Hi, I'm from the tribe of Manasseh. You know, we're kicking all the people out of the land. Will you please leave?
No.
Okay. Joshua, we have this problem. They won't leave. Well, no. The problem wasn't that they weren't strong enough to drive these people out. In fact, when they were far weaker, God was doing all the driving. Are we clear on that? God is doing all the driving. If you want to be victorious, there is no one who can stand against you. The problem was the people of Israel enjoyed the Canaanites' lifestyle. They enjoyed the Canaanites' lifestyle. There were things about the Canaanites that were to be envied. There was a reason why they didn't drive them out. By the end of this book of Scripture, we'll be looking at some of the attraction that they have to the Canaanite women and so forth. I want you to think back with me. Think back with me. You're living in Egypt. You're making bricks for a living. And you get to see all the trappings of, you know, pyramids or whatever, and, you know, King whoever, pharaohs. You got all this kind of urban lifestyle. It's kind of interesting. It's no wonder the people, when they're walking around in the wilderness, said to Moses, whoa, why don't we go back to Egypt? You know, at least they had Starbucks. The people of Israel who were in the wilderness wanderings didn't have much at all. They got out basically with the shirts on their back. They had some tents, and they lived a nomadic lifestyle. How did they get food? Came out of heaven. Manna. 150 different ways to cook manna. Hey, I found the new way. What'd you mix with it? Quail. Think of the fashion of the people of Israel after wandering around for 40 years. I mean, it's a miracle that their clothes didn't wear out, right? I mean, that was the whole thing God provided for them. Their clothes didn't wear out. I mean, you know, they're not the movers and shakers, as you and I would think. You know, they're coming into the promised land, and you know, what are they finding? What are they finding? The word Canaan, a Canaanite, literally the word Canaan comes from the word purple, the purple land, land of purple. Somehow the Canaanites had found some shellfish that they could extract something out of and get a dye, and so they could make purple clothing. Pretty cool, right? It'd be purple houses, purple hair, you name it, purple in your food. I don't know. I mean, it was, you know, purple. When the people of Israel came in, the people of Israel were exposed to something that was much more sophisticated. It is no wonder that Deuteronomy chapter 6 cries out with a warning that when you come into this new land, you don't forget about me. Because the tendency was for their eyes to get enormously large as they looked around and they saw the sophistication of that day and age. There were, for 500 years prior to the people of Israel coming into the promised land, a people called the Canaanites, this purple people eater, they had taken from 500 years of cultures around them and brought all kinds of cultures in. We think of their wickedness and we think of their sinfulness, and that's a good thing to think about. But they also were very cutting edge. They were your urban people. They had done extremely significant things in the area of an alphabet and language. They had done significant things with regard to their calendar. Their arts were developed. And so you had all of this going on. Meanwhile, you're one of the people of Israel. You've been 40 years in the wilderness. You got a pair of shoes. You don't know why they're not wearing out. You've never been to an outlet mall. And now all of a sudden you walk in and you see this stuff. It is, listen, we're hard on Achan. But when you stop and think about this, I mean, Achan sees a robe and he picks it up and thinks, man, this is the best thing I've ever seen. And he buries it. It's no wonder. They haven't seen any of these things. And God is pleading with them and he's saying, listen, don't forget me. Don't forget me. But there was also the wickedness that was associated with their worship. We didn't know much about all of the culture among the Canaanite people until a little bit over a century ago, when some of the texts, Ugaritic texts, were found in North Syria coast, and it has backed up what the scripture has said and expanded it significantly so that we know quite a bit about the Canaanite people. All of the sin surrounding their religious practices were abominations, and yet they were so geared towards the sensual that the people of Israel were falling for it. By the time you come to Joshua or Judges chapter 2, you're looking at it from a different perspective, and you're looking at it and saying, why are these people, the people of God, abandoning the reality of what God has called them to be? Sometimes people debate about whether or not we should shelter our kids, you know. I hear discussions about that. Should we just, you know, maybe we shouldn't shelter our kids. You know, that way when they get older, they won't boom, go right into sin. So we'll just kind of like get them accustomed to it. The people of Israel are the most sheltered people on the planet when they walk into Canaan. They haven't seen anything. Their TVs didn't get any reception in the wilderness. I mean, their cell phones didn't get a signal. I mean, nothing. And here they are, only dependent upon God for all of those 40 years, and now they're walking in. They are a sheltered people. And yet, even as sheltered people, even as adults, they go headlong into the sin. My friends, listen. Don't worry about your kids being sheltered. Don't even have that discussion. It's stupid. We all need a shelter. We all need to be sheltered. Some of us as adults have a greater propensity to sin than our children do. You and I need to understand we need to shelter ourselves from sin. This is what God was saying to his people when he's saying to his people, drive these guys out. Don't mess with them. You're going to get their house. You're going to get their big screen. You're going to get all their cars. You're going to get all that stuff, but don't deal with them because they'll corrupt you. They'll turn your heart away from me, and I'm going to come and destroy you because of it if it ever happens. The people of Israel were discontent, disillusioned, but they were being drawn in. They were being drawn in to a sinful lifestyle. It wasn't that they couldn't drive them out. They didn't want to drive them out. They wanted to grab a hold of the world and hold on tight. I was thinking about this, and I was trying to put it into some type of an illustration or a story in my mind, and I came up with the idea that the Lord has provided everything that we need to live victorious in the Christian life. And so oftentimes we're told we can't live victoriously. This world is too hard to live victoriously in. Now, I'll grant you this, this world is hard to live victoriously in, but it's not impossible. In fact, what God has done is God has given to us the power of the Spirit of the Lord. And we can be victorious even in 2017. And I don't know what it's going to be like in 2025 or 2050 or 2100 if God tarries, but I know that Christians will still be able to live victoriously for Christ. The decision was their decision. The contrast is so clear, is it not, between the sons of Joseph and Caleb? Caleb is a godly man. He wants to see God work. He wants these people driven out because it was God's proclamation and command to do so, and he understood the reasoning behind it. His love for God drives him to a place of spiritual victory, whereas these people want the world. And so their problem was, we need more space, and because we're living with the Canaanites, you see, we have a problem there. The population's high, but it's not high because of them alone. It's high because they wanted the Canaanites to be along for the ride. They had a decision to make. Imagine if you were a person with no means, but the Lord invited you to go on his train. So the angel meets you at the train station and hands you a ticket that you didn't purchase. And the train is a place of blessing, and it's taking you to a land spiritually that is blessed, a land of peace, a land of spiritual victory. There's no consequences of sin there because you're walking with the Lord and you're enjoying his fellowship. You're so excited for this journey. You're excited for the destination. You take the ticket from the angel, and you're about ready to set foot on that train. And all of a sudden, something in your ear, a sound that you're not familiar with, catches your attention. You look, and you see out of the corner of your eye something moving. And so all of a sudden, you're drawn away, and you turn, and you look. You smell a smell that you've never smelled before. You hear things you've never heard before. There's music. There's distraction. And you step back from the train, and you turn, and you begin to follow your senses. You follow your senses, and you find it's a carnival of sorts. There are things that are appealing to your senses there. You're led away and down some aisleways, and you're going along, and all of a sudden, what grips you next is the sound of a train whistle. The train is leaving the station, and there you are standing there with the ticket still in your hand. You made a decision, and the decision has taken you to a place where God didn't want you to go, and you're missing out on the blessings of God. How many times do you hear Christians complain? Complain, complain, complain. Because we're not living a victorious Christian lifestyle. We're not walking with the Lord like he's intended for us to walk. We're not daily in his word. We're not communing with him regularly with prayer. And we're not in a relationship that's thriving. I want you to know that that is our choice. God doesn't bend our will. He doesn't coerce us in any way. He gives us the opportunity. Joshua, at the end of chapter 17, looks at these sons of Joseph and he tells them straight up, here's the way it is. And I love the words because they're just so forthright. Where we find here in verse 17, Joshua spoke to the house of Joseph, Ephraim and Manasseh, saying, you are a numerous people, have great power. You shall not have one lot only, but the hill country shall be yours. For though it is a forest, you shall clear it. And to its farthest borders, it shall be yours, and you shall drive out the Canaanites, even though they have chariots of iron, and though they are strong. You need to do the right thing. You need to desire what God wants from your life. Now, you and I, as believers today, have the opportunity to walk with the Lord in such a new way, in such a different way. I think of Ephesians chapter 4, and I think of what is spoken of here. In verse 17, it says, "So this I say and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart." You stand to be totally different than the world. You've placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. You are now a new creature, and you are rewired even in the way in which you think. So when you come down to chapter 5 and verse 1, it says, "Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma." You see, you and I, as children of God, have been given to us all of the provision that we need. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. So why? The man of God may be complete, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. You see, God has done everything for us. He's given us the ticket. And he tells us, here's the place of blessing. It doesn't mean that there's no trials in your life. It doesn't mean that the roads don't intersect with a sinful world. Those things will happen. But understand this. It is a place of joy that you will be able to thrive in, even though there are trials, even though there are difficulties. You'll walk with the Lord, and your relationship with God will thrive. That's what God wants. And that's what God wants for his people here in the Old Testament. He wants them to enjoy this new land. He's given it all to them. But there won't be enjoyment. There won't be blessing if you absolutely have to hold on to the sin of the Canaanite. If you're enamored with their world, if you're enamored with their lifestyle, there will not be blessing. And so the choice for the people of Israel, in my mind at least, is very similar to us today. We have choices to make. God says, you can be blessed. You can thrive in your spiritual relationship, in your walk with me. Or you can seek to be pulled away and fall the way of the world. If you do that, you'll forfeit the blessings. But the choice certainly is yours. Let's pray. This morning, I encourage you today to take a moment to look into your own heart and examine first and foremost, am I a child of Jesus Christ? Am I part of that group that it's being described there in Ephesians chapter 5? Or have I yet to make that decision to place my faith in Jesus Christ? There is a question in your heart and mind. Let me urge you today to get answers that come from the scriptures that would lead you to ultimately place your faith in Jesus Christ, in him alone. For there is salvation in no other. There is no other name. And if you're here this morning and you say, I have placed my faith in Jesus Christ, that's a wonderful reality. And you know the joy of that. You know the peace that's yours because you don't wonder where you're going to spend your eternity. And yet perhaps today there's a struggle that's very real. The desire to follow the world. The desire to pass up the blessings. And to do it your way. If you're here this morning and God's at work in your heart, right now with your head bowed, would you talk to the Lord? Would you tell the Lord that he's more important than the world? Would you be willing to follow him? Father, our desire today is to be people who are in the place of blessing. Knowing, Lord, that today, if we place our faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the Holy Spirit of God, and we can be filled with the Spirit of God. And as a ramification of that filling, Lord, we know that we'll exhibit the fruit of the Spirit, Help us to be that person, Lord, who is thriving in our relationship with you. Father, we thank you for doing everything for us possible. Everything that we needed, you've prepared the way to victory. And Lord, we stand before you today without an excuse. We recognize, Lord, that the consequences of sin is something that's real. But we own our sin today, Lord. We don't excuse it. We don't push it off on someone else, but Father, we accept it. And understand, Lord, that it's the result of a decision that was made that was wrong. And so, Father, we come today to repent of that sin and seek a relationship with you that is one that is marked by victory and blessing. Thank you, Lord, for making this all possible for us. May you be glorified by your children today, I pray in Christ's name. Amen.